Good afternoon, RSA 2020. I'm Steve Reznik, and I'm back after all I said last year. And this year, I'm happy to be presenting with Allison Seidel.
Hi, everyone. I'm Allison Seidel, and I'm very happy to be presenting here at RSA, where Steve and I are asking, what's in your risk assessment?
Hey, Allison, did you know the times are changing in cybersecurity risk management?
Yes, Steve. Old school qualitative reporting not only leaves the board members vulnerable, it leaves them powerless. They don't know what to invest in. They just know they should be uncomfortable.
Well, today we want to help you get started with articulating risk and cybersecurity investment strategy in financial terms. In short, instead of that scary looking heat map, think loss exceedance curve and trade studies.
Yes, we'll cover those and much more.
So let's get started. We do have three poll questions. As you know, we've been working on it already. So have your apps ready and you can vote now if you want, and then we'll look at the results as we get there.
And finally, what we say today is our own personal views and does not represent our current companies.
Great. So are we aligned? We're looking at risk assessment today. So looking at the word risk and assessment, two words, but they could be used way more than two ways. When you think of risk, every executive is paid to take risks. They know about general risk taking, general risk assessment, and they understand that things like strategic risk is something that you try a lot of stuff, keep what works. It's good. It's good to take that kind of risk. There's usually a lot of upside, not quite as much downside as long as you're trying to innovate and you're out there in the game. And they also understand other enterprise risks, like market risk, credit risk, and operational risk. And they understand that they need to understand this in order to make a decision. Businesses run on decisions. They don't run on procedures or checklists, which may be what many people think of as a risk assessment. But in the end, it needs to support a decision. And what we're going to talk about today is IT security may be thinking of risk as a heat map. So we want to talk about the limitations and why we need to start thinking about distributions.
Over the last few days, we've seen that at this point, some attendees may leave to check out other sessions.
Oh, don't worry about that. We've checked them out. There's 18. This is the place to be.
Indeed, this is the place to be for a probabilistic approach, which means you can estimate a return on control and mitigation that is often recommended but rarely actually given a methodology to calculate. Value to help support business decisions, and compliance to meet external regulator requirements.
Wow, all at the same time. Now we know that it's a full session today and there's a session viewing point. So I'm gonna give a shout out to everyone in the session viewing point. Hey, if you sit on the left, you can see better, and please don't surf the channel because this is the channel to be. We think you'll just come back to this channel eventually. Got it. This is the better risk assessment channel. So speaking of those two terms again, we're going to just examine them a bit. We're going to look at what they mean a bit. The key word for risk is event. And the other words are probable frequency, probable magnitude. Something's happening. Something has an effect. On the assessment side, the key words are amount and decision. So we're looking at the amount of probable frequency and probable magnitude of future loss based on an event. And we want to support a decision. Now moving on, key questions.
And so yes, today we're asking four key questions to judge a risk assessment. The where and the what, the how much, and the how much more or less if. The where and what is your asset and your event. The how, think loss scenarios. How much, think risk factors, loss exposure. And finally, how much more or less if, we'll cover in the case study.
Thank you, Allison. Where's the risk assessment? Last year I did where's the risk, which means where's the event. Where's the risk assessment is similar. So take a look, and there's 13 over there. Does anything look like it answers all four of these questions posed by Allison? I don't think any given one answers them all. Maybe if someone thinks so, they can challenge us later. I don't even think most of those are better than the first, expert intuition alone. Because yes, you can use expert intuition and come to some conclusions. You may not be able to explain the mental model, but you can get some answers. A lot of these other ones are more checklist based. And
hey, Steve, yes. What is that appearing slowly up there? Did you see that?
That's the heat map. And actually, it's in its place. It's actually technically called an ISO 31010 consequence probability matrix. So it's coming in there right where it's being defined as.
All right, it's time to get out your conference apps and collect some data.
Okay. Here we go.
Does your risk assessment include industry costs?
So vote away. So we're at 72% no, and we've got 12% yes so far.
Wow.
And how does that compare to what we expected?
We were expecting 40 to 60% as yes.
Yes, so we're expecting a little more.
Yeah, Okay. But we'll focus on that today. So.
Okay, we're gonna help you become better consumers of industry data. Does your
risk assessment include probability distributions?
That's actually a little more.
Yeah, we were only expecting 20 to 40%. So
we're right in the range.
Yeah.
Okay.
And finally,
thank you for voting.
Does your risk assessment include trade studies?
And we were expecting
0 to 20 on this.
0 to 20.
Yeah.
So we're going to go into what a trade study means and how we have some suggestions to go about it. Get back here.
So polling is over now, and this little guy would love for you to take him home. I have a friend who transports dogs from rural areas to cities where there are many more adoptable parents. And so this little guy is now in a happy home.
Great. So the meaning here is to put down your phone, and we don't need the phone anymore.
Yeah. Just stare at that lovely dog.
How to get started. So Allison and I put our heads together, and we boiled it all down to 5 what we call visible artifacts of probabilistic risk assessment, beginning with assets, moving to loss event scenarios, to data, probability distributions, trade studies. So there can be a fair amount of procedures underneath, a fair amount of drama getting to these places, a fair amount of going back and forth. But in the end, we think these are the things that you'll see visibly in reports or wherever as progress is being made.
Hey, this must be my slide.
Assets, Allison. Here we go.
Nice. Risk exists where value can be lost or diminished, revenue generators and services, liability can materialize, where you have a lot of personally identifiable information and you need service availability, or resources can be wasted.
Okay. How much risk is associated with?
How much risk is, oh, yes. The where what. A risk that I had written when I was in a prior job in enterprise risk management was related to obsolescence of technology. But because I had never picked any asset or vulnerable technology, I could never get any management attention on it. Specifically, I couldn't pinpoint the revenue and productivity losses that would occur if that technology wasn't available. Maybe if I had said, you know, what would it cost the company if the trading platform were shut down for a day? And I think from the human element, I might have gotten a well, that's not possible. So I think it would have been easier for me to kind of start with, well, what are the costs associated with the trading platform being down for 2 hours? So, and be able to kind of build that management attention on this risk.
And the asset in that case was?
The trading platform.
Trading platform. So that helped answer the question, how much risk is associated with, and that's what you were caring about.
Yes.
In your assessments. Okay. All right. So is that how someone looks after 4 days of RSA? All right. Better go home. Loss event scenarios. This question I created about 7 weeks ago before certain recent events, which may have an impact here. First, I want to ask, are there any services in the audience? Or what's that other word? RPAs? He's supposed to laugh at that one. Okay, there's an RPA. Got it. So you don't count. Anyway, let's talk about what this means. We're talking about calibration. So Alice is going to talk about data, industry data in a bit. But if you don't have certain kinds of data, you can actually calibrate humans. And you can use them to develop defensible estimates to put into the model. So maybe someone's reaction might be a lot. Okay, that means a certain thing to certain people, but it can mean different things. More than last year means probably something different now than it did when I wrote the question. It might be the other way. 36,524 is appealing, and a lot of people go for this sort of thing, but it's what's called precisely wrong. It's not going to help anything, and it actually may make things worse. What do you think of this? Are we pretty confident it's somewhere in this range?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't even know if they published an actual exact count, because the report from last year was 42,500 thereabouts or something. So if someone goes to the expo for 10 minutes, does it count? So who knows? Depends on the swag they get. What about this answer? This might still work. Okay. But if you were planning for backpacks, okay, that might be good. Okay, if you were planning for food or drinks, maybe not. So it depends. It depends. So a lot of this depends on the decision that needs to be made, how much you need, and you can always go back and gather more information. So basically, we're talking about embracing the uncertainty here. So I didn't create that quote, and I don't know who's claiming it, but it's good. Embrace the uncertainty. Go with what you got. You don't need perfect data. And calibration is the process you can go through to get better estimates, and you can actually calibrate a little bit more.
Steve.
Yes.
There it is again.
Yeah, there it is. Well, at least the heat map does know its place. Essentially, it's a point estimate, and the weakness there is the fact that it collapses ranges down into points and gives a false sense of precision that usually can cause problems.
I've never been stalked by a heat map before.
Well, let's hope he goes away, or she. Loss event scenario factors. So we're basically what we talked about before about how many people, humans, are attending, goes into these buckets. And it really comes down to estimating threat events, frequency, how often threats happen, and comparing and estimating our vulnerability to the threats, how often, what percentage are they successful, and then estimating impact. Magnitude. That's the core elements of quantitative risk analysis modeling.
So we can do this without filling out every one of these boxes?
Exactly. You don't have to fill out all the boxes. In fact, you can start with a sheet of paper and you can actually state the asset, the threat community affecting the asset, and you can talk about the particular effect, like a CIA, confidentiality, integrity, availability. And you can just write down simple factors. What makes it more likely? What makes it less likely? What makes it less impactful, more impactful? And that'll go a long way. It's served me very well over the years. And then you can always springboard from that into more calibrated ranges, actual numerical estimates. But this forces you to actually understand the assets at risk and the scenarios.
We'll talk about data.
Look at that.
Ha-ha. Must be me again. Doug Hubbard says, your problem is not as unique as you think. You have more data than you think, and you need less data than you think. And actually, that's what I'm going to talk about in the next slide. There's an adequate amount, more data out there than you think. And then our friend Jack Jones took it one more step to calibration methods and using on subject matter experts to provide good estimates. As Steve just said, embrace the uncertainty.
So attention, cyber risk data shoppers. Clean up, aisle 10.
So on the left are the types of costs there. These are the secondary response costs. So if you're gonna go out and look for data, those are the types of data you would have. And then in the middle there are some external sources. And the story is here, you know, I've found eight. And they're not all complete. Some of them cost money. Some of them are kind of your insurance company, Tower Street. But this is a growing industry. I do see in a few years this list growing much longer. And so, but those are only data breaches. So finally, on the last column here, I have our subject matter experts internally that you might use for any analysis to help you gather your data. Oh, and there's my little shopping guy. That's my cue to get going. So, but a tried and true, I should mention the Verizon data breach report because it's the oldest source around and it's been used for a lot. But it's getting pretty dated now. I think the last time they actually included costs was 2015.
And Allison has a blog post.
Oh,
on this very topic on the Fair Institute website. She went into some more detail here and she talked about Consumer Reports type rating of the sources.
Yeah, and how your company might choose out of those sources. And a lot of free information.
Great. So probability distributions and trade studies. Which trade studies also means?
Cost-benefit analyses.
Yes, but more than just that. And the reason I like the term, let me change that, is because back in the Air Force, I was a math major, but then I got in the Air Force with engineering, systems engineering, and then they use this term trade studies. I never heard of it before. So I was trying to understand, what are you talking about? So basically, when you're building nuclear missiles and they're flying, you need to trade off between beryllium, aluminum, these characteristics of memory, those characteristics. So it's something that's always stuck with me. And I think something that can add value to the discipline of cybersecurity risk management and estimating cyber risk going forward. So I'm trying the term out. It's a little more than cost benefit, and I'll cover that in a bit. But before that, probability distributions, I want you just to know what they are. We're going to show some later on in the case study. The left is a histogram, and it actually just puts buckets of the results of the Monte Carlo simulations into common columns. So then you can actually look at probabilities based on how high those columns are. And this is actually done for when you do financial portfolio management. If you actually have an investment portfolio, you may have gone to your financial advisor, they hit a button and they tell you the probability of having no money in retirement, basically, which could vary based on interest rates and other factors. But it's kind of a similar idea. So that would be a very tail end, I guess, risk where you would not have the money in retirement to do what you want. Loss exceedance curve is basically the same thing. It's just turned a bit and it's actually showing for each probability that you want to talk about, let's say 20%, it'll tell you how much loss has that probability. So in this case, we have a 20% chance of more than 10 million. So in this case, an appetite was set at 10 million. So that may be okay if that management's okay with that type of a probability. And the bottom one is a statement, but it's essentially a point on a loss exceedance curve. So the bottom one is kind of a risk appetite statement where you can work with management and talk in their terms. In this case, it's customer transactions. It's not an actual dollar amount. But after that meeting with management, you could translate that into a dollar amount and then use it in a quantitative way. So here's the trade study concept. And the first thing that comes to my mind is the Get Smart Cones of Silence. Has anybody heard of that show, Get Smart? Seen a few hands. They remade it into a new movie, so I figure I can get away with old sitcoms if they've remade them into a movie. But basically, in the Cones of Silence, you have Maxwell Smart, the secret agent, and if they're back at headquarters talking about some plan or something with senior management, they scratch their head and they say, well, wait a second, this is pretty sensitive stuff. We don't want chaos to hear it. So maybe we need the Cones of Silence. And you know what happens next? The cones come down around Maxwell Smart, they come down around his boss, and then they can't hear each other. They're knocking on the cones and they're using sign language, and then they finally raise the cones back up and they say, well, okay, what were we talking about? So that, to me, that's an example of a disruptive type control, which is beyond the cost benefit. It's more something where you need to look at that factor. So it may be great, it may work in the lab, it may prevent threats from getting to your core assets, but it may shut down your business at the same time. So that's what I'm talking about with a trade study, where you look at more than just cost. So external requirements for risk assessment. So Allison and I actually met with a Fair Institute project where we looked into regulations, and wherever they said the word risk assessment, we went in there and copy-pasted that wording and put it in a nice compendium, and it is available on the Fair Institute website, and we went back and forth on what all those things meant. And here was our population. And the idea is that if you're a regulated party, it's really kind of up to you sometimes to figure out, you know, does my heat map allow my organization to sufficiently address critical objectives, right? Such as regulated.
Did you just say regulated party?
Yes.
Is that, how do I get to that party? I don't see it on the conference app.
Yeah. I didn't download the app, so I can't help you there. Okay, well, regulated party, there might be one later on. We'll find out. Anyway, we are making a little light of this, but we want to map it, map it to the questions that we're
right.
talking about. Because we've looked at a lot of the wording across the regulations. You can take, Allison, if you want to know one.
GDPR for the where and the what and the how much less if. Like, it's kind of getting at that's what you should be doing.
Yes, and a lot of it's not that prescriptive. And then on the NIST-CSF side, again, NIST-CSF is mostly control type activities in the end, objectives. And then they say, do a risk assessment and prioritize. So again, it's kind of up to you. But we're going to keep an eye on these. We have a link to these in the presentation. It's on the Fair Institute website. And this should be maintained over time, what we call the compliance mapping. So it's a risk assessment overview for practitioners that are actually out there trying to do quantitative risk management. And we plan to keep an eye on what the regulations are saying. So looky here, we have our case study.
Bank of the Vale, a regional mid-sized revenue bank, about $6 billion, has about 5 million regular customers, long-term accounts, and some prospects. They actually have a database internally with about 40 million sensitive records and prospects. They have some risk drivers that are driving things with this company. Rapid growth, which is leading to high turnover. Cost cutting of middle office operations through outsourcing. And their competitor, Bank of the Isles, recently got breached.
That's a lot to assess. Yeah. Okay. So Bank of the Vale actually has a risk appetite. So we're actually ahead of the game there, believe it or not. And I took this from Jack Jones's presentation last year at RSA, which is still available. But he talked about developing some of these statements, how you go about it. But we're going to benefit from them being there. So we're not talking about risk appetite development today, but it is there as a gauge for the risk assessment. And here we are on Bank of the Vale's assets.
Yeah, the biggest thing we're going to talk about, our big case study is on the customer database, the main one I described earlier. Some other things that might be of interest are email, which has unstructured data and is used in business processes. Mainframe applications used for branch employees and business banking. Third parties, as I mentioned, used for middle office trading. So without this third party, trading is halted. And web platform for consumer and business banking, and a trading platform for actually entering the trades. That's the front office end.
So we've, so far in our assessment, we've developed 9 scenarios, loss event scenarios, and they are organized by the asset Allison just mentioned, and the threat against the asset, the threat type, give it a little more flavor, and the threat effect. And on the left is Bank of the Vale actually has a nice enterprise taxonomy of loss events that we're mapping to that, so it's easier to understand compared to other enterprise risks. So we're in good shape there. We've done a lot of development. We've got some buy-in that these are the top 9. Now we just need to understand how much. So Allison's going to tell us about some of these numbers. So they didn't just appear from the sky. A lot of what we've talked about so far with calibrating subject matter experts, going out to industry, gathering it all and compiling it went into some of these numbers.
Yeah, so our threat event frequency, that is the TEF, the top line there. It's the number of annualized times a cyber criminal attempts to steal the Bank of the Vale's customer database. And so we had analysts go out and interview people for this assignment.
Did you say Anna List?
I did say Anna List.
She works at Bank of the Vale.
She does.
Got it.
Along with Smeagol, who she interviewed. So Anna List explains the scenario and this idea of a threat foothold concept to Smeagol. And Smeagol was shy at first, but then he happily provided an estimate to Anna about after she calibrated him. And then she went to the database administrator who provided a percentage of elevated accounts for the compromise credential angle. So what we did was we took the number of times they got that malware got that far into the as a foothold times the percentage of administrator accounts to estimate an annual threat event frequency.
All right, and then resistant strength. So threat capability is standard. It's used across all the threats communities. So that's our standard scales for cyber criminals. But what about resistance strengths, Allison, to the threats?
Resistance strength is the measure of how difficult it is for the cyber criminal to steal the Bank of the Vale's customer database. And Decision Maker actually paid for a red team to measure the effect of our current controls around the customer database.
Thank you, D.
Yeah. So we had a red team exercise.
And we have some pretty large mega bucks at the bottom there. How were those developed?
Right. That's secondary loss magnitude. So these are this magnitude are the Bank of the Vale stakeholders, the trading partners, the regulators, the market. These are the people that would be affected and the cost that the company would bear in the event that a large database like this was breached.
And what is SLEF?
SLEF, secondary loss event frequency. So that's the number of times. See, we're set at 100 there, so there's nothing. What we'd ask Decision Maker, is there anything that might prevent this data from being used by the cyber criminal? And his answer was no at this point. So if they get the data, they have the data, and they can use it for their purposes.
D's a man?
No, maybe not.
Okay.
I don't know.
Well, we'll go. I've never met D, so. Anyway, next. We're looking at the loss event scenarios quantified now, and this is what it would look like. And we've got a range, which is good, and this is kind of how it all ends up being able to be compared. So this will allow you to actually compare your top risks. And as you can see, there are some ones that are very large, with a maximum worst-case ever scenario of 230 million, and you've got some small stuff, but you've got a variation. Here's one way of looking at it. If you just take looking at the 90th percentile, the ones that are the top there, you have that big customer database with the cyber criminal breaching it. And the way the loss exceedance curve looks is it says a 10% probability of loss is greater than 160 million. So that is something management can look at. They can compare that to the appetite. At the bottom, we've got the flip side of 90%, meaning almost certain losses greater than 3 million, and this happens to be at a third party, and it's ransomware. So we've actually got a concern here because it is not just an exposure, it's an imminent loss based on the model, and we're gonna look at some options for that. So you can compare the scenarios this way and actually look at the ranges, and you see the one on the left, the big one spiking up there, and what we'll do is take that one away, and now we're just left with 8, and we'll actually compare those. And you can actually see how there's a variation there. And on the web disruption,
there's that heat map slowly appearing again.
Yeah, okay. I think it actually has something to say this
time.
Yeah,
maybe.
What is it gonna say?
Of course.
Those risks are high risk. So Captain Obvious heat map, yes, we're aware of that they're high. We're trying to actually compare them. So maybe let us get on with that. And now let's compare it to the risk appetite. So you've got the top risk here, and the risk appetite before basically translated into that red line where we're saying, yeah, management only wants a 10% chance of more than 10 million, but we're actually at, it looks almost like 35 or so. So we're well above risk appetite in this case, so we really need to look at some options here, and that's what we're gonna get into from the library.
Right. This trade study library gives us some options for things that we could look at to reduce risk. And for example, over on the left side there's database internalization. That would reduce your contact frequency. So essentially that would be taking your vault from being out in the main open to putting it in the basement where not everybody's seeing it all the time. Then UDD is an unauthorized device detection. So that improves the resistance strength of a company. Basically, kind of what we're thinking through is here, where in the scenario will we be able to stop the cyber criminal from getting all the way to that database?
Okay, so we're gonna highlight a few, and we don't have time to review all of these. But we actually highlighted a few we're going to take a look at, and we're going to focus on that 90th percentile and then the 10th percentile scenario. And the 90th percentile is the big breach, and we've actually got a comparison here of the risk reduction benefit to cost ratio of these options. And Allison, maybe take us through a couple. I see purge up there. It says SLM. What does that do?
Right. Ordinarily, it would reduce secondary loss magnitude, but in this case, it's not happening since we weren't able to reduce the data by an order of magnitude. So basically, Bank of the Vale is using most of the data they have, and they can't get rid of a lot of it. But you'll see the next option there, encryption, is highly effective against this particular threat community because it's unlikely that the cyber criminal would be able to access the key store and the data, or even realize that the data was encrypted until the grab and go is complete. And that, for that, we reduced that secondary loss event frequency that we had at 100 on that first slide, we reduced it.
Okay, and then insurance is a different animal altogether. What does insurance do?
Risk transference. Anything over 40 million would be borne by the insurer. So we would, that's how our 90% cap.
So what we did here is we actually went into the results of the Monte Carlo simulation, and if it was more than 40 million, we changed it to 40 million.
Tapped it off.
Assuming the insurance worked and all that worked out. Yep. Now, what is zero trust? There's been many sessions on that. And has any session actually talked about a risk factor modification?
Not that I'm aware of.
So what do we have?
This one raises the resistance strength in the middle of the diagram there. It raises the ability of the company to prevent the cyber criminal from using those compromised credentials to become the database administrator.
And then I see tokenize and purge and tokenize. What is all that?
So tokenize reduces your secondary loss event frequency. And the thought behind purging and tokenizing is that it would be cheaper to tokenize with less data.
Absolutely. So you have more cost.
Oh, there
less
it is
cost
again.
For risk reduction. Oh, yeah, there it is again. It thinks we're showing off. Well, I don't think we're showing off. We're actually just trying to help management and heat map. If it's beyond you, then just let's move on. Now we have ransomware, and we're going to talk just really quickly about the two options here and some really good risk reduction benefit to cost ratios.
Yeah, one was reducing the recovery time objective because the losses would be for a shorter period of time. There would be less employee idle time. And so you'd have a reduced loss, but we'd possibly pay a vendor to run through drills and invest in infrastructure to make those backups faster. And then a second option to hire another vendor to increase awareness to administer that training for users. There we found a vendor that promised a reduced click rate of 30 to 60%. So
you can see the big ratios there. Everyone says awareness training is very good. This shows it. We actually modeled how awareness training has a high ROI in this case.
And Steve, you could do both.
Yes, we could. We don't have time. Now, wrapping it up, those are the five visible artifacts. And we believe that if you focus on those, you're going to be answering these questions. And then that's going to, in the end, help with compliance because most of what we see from a compliance perspective maps to the questions. That was the idea. So wrapping things up, we have a quick troubleshooting your risk assessment slide here. What are you going to do if no one seems to care? Well, our idea is that you might want to toss the heat map and stop thinking as findings as risk. And I do want to give credit to Angelo Vinco for this nice picture, very insightful. And what about if you have no idea what to do next? Well, have you mapped assets? Are you thinking about loss event scenarios? Are you looking at factors? Are you going back to the scenario? What if what you're doing is not used for a strategic decision? Well, why don't you compare cost and risk reduction benefit? We talked about it today, how to go about that. We've got lots of tools we'll show you in a bit. And what about you can't aggregate? Well, Bank of the Vale actually has a loss event taxonomy, so that was great. So if anyone else is trying to map to some kind of a breach or ransomware, those kind of terms, they're standardized for the company. And then a key thing is to use quantitative ranges first. Don't jump to your labels. Don't jump to red, yellow, green. It's okay to maybe do that in the end, but begin with numbers. Begin with ranges because it's easy to embrace the uncertainty, as we talked about before.
And so this is the perfect slide for what you're looking for later. We talk about the where and what, and this is a link to Jack Jones's talk last year on cyber risk appetite, Doug Hubbard's book on how to measure anything in cybersecurity, Jack's book on managing and measuring risk, and then the FAIR Institute has a lot of resources. So that'll get you to the how much down there, Doug Hubbard's other book, How to Measure Anything, and effectively leveraging data in FAIR analyses, another white paper by Jack. The next thing up there is my shopping blog on cyber loss data with a lot of research I did. Then the FAIR open course has some examples in there too. And then how or much more or less if, what makes a good KRI by our own Steve Reznik last year. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah. So recapping up, your risk assessment procedure should include steps for where, what, how much more or less if, and mapping, which we've shown you how to do and we have resources. And you should be able to answer those questions in your reports. And you should actually note how you're meeting requirements, and we think it's pretty straightforward to do that. Now you can actually assign resources and prioritize budget and provide value with compliance. So your homework is to actually identify critical assets and their value. You can use our diamond idea. That was Allison's idea. That's great. You can document loss event factors. Looking at it, those tables we showed you, you can identify external requirements by doing some research and understanding what regulations may apply to you and seeing what they say about risk assessment. Then you can shop for data. Allison has some nice blogs and reviews, and there's that other Jack Jones document there about cyber data shopping. And you can analyze loss win factors and map to external requirements and expand scope. And a little further wrap up, we just want to say that we really appreciate you coming here today and listening to our ideas.
Is that sound what I think it is?
Yeah.
Looks like that thing is never...
I guess that heat map didn't like the trash can.
Guess not. Looks like that thing is never going to go away on its own. Who are we going to call?
It's gone. Okay. Well, again, as we were saying, we want to thank you for showing up. All right. Oh, come on, heat map. You had a good run, spouting your fear, uncertainty, and doubt all these years.
Can't this thing just go away?
Yeah, don't go away, Matt. Just go away. Man, look at that little five by five gremlin go. All right.
We've called in the professionals now.
Attention risk assessment team. The heat map has taken a class 4 physical form and is parting at the local brewery. We've dispatched an economic disposal unit.
For your information, a class 4 physical form means that identity is established and it has a distinct human form and personality with known identities, such as General Custer or Cleopatra. Economic disposal methods include research into the background of said entity, as well as possible communication with it, or catching it red-handed at the local brewery. Let's go.
Let's go. There we go. We got heat map. And it's trapped. Time to get on with modern risk assessment approaches such as industry costs, probability distributions, and trade studies. Thank you very much. All right.
That's awesome, Steve.
So please come up to the microphone if you have a question. We have time. 10 minutes.
10 whole minutes.
Are there any questions?
I think everybody's ready to go to the brewery now that we said it.
Yes, exactly. I think I missed that. That was night before last. If you're in the session viewing point, come on over and ask a question if you want. We'll be here for a while.
Yeah.
Any questions? So there is the PDF on the RSA website, and it does have links, quite a few links embedded in it.
Hi, last one.
Hello, good afternoon.
Hi.
Hi.
So in a large organization, how do you handle multi-layered controls over tens of thousands of assets? We've looked at the book, we've kind of done a few different versions ourselves, and that's really the challenge that a lot of people who read the report have.
It's true. Do you want me to go ahead and...
You got it.
Yeah. We've struggled with just that exact question. And what we've ended up doing is trying to define the asset down at the application level, and then trying to apply the environment around that and just get down to like one thing in it versus trying to kind of boil the ocean or, you know, look at the whole thing at once. Does that make sense? Right. Right. Mm-hmm. One thing that we've done is that we've looked at resistance strength across the corporation and set a resistance strength for the whole corporation, and then looked at that individual application and said, okay, this application has these issues. Let's take off from that score. Does that make sense? You're welcome.
The key is to start and to start running some broad scenarios and build from that. But I understand it's a complex problem, and I do hear there is more guidance on controls on the way later in the year from the FAIR Institute. They do plan to publish some more guidance on controls, so you don't have to do as much resistance strength stuff. You can do a lot more precursor to that and actually get to things like that. Thanks. Oh, yes, question over here.
Yes, having dealt with various models of risk assessment over the years, the one criticism that I have of all of them is that minor changes to probabilities of events or dollar values of your outcomes of things that can go wrong or whatever, you can make these risk assessments say whatever you want them to say. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the key there is really transparency of the inputs, I would say, and to understand where the numbers are coming from and the sources and the calibration methods of the sources, and have a bias towards what they call telemetry data and the more objective type forms of data versus the human estimators. But if that's not available, then in the end you have to embrace the uncertainty.
Yeah.
And you have to actually do something. Because would you rather have a mental model, or would you rather actually have something that actually has some actual relationships amongst control options and other factors?
I'm not sure that I have the answer either. Yeah. I'd just like to point out that I'm not sure how useful any of it really is. So.
Well, that same question was asked 40 years ago for modeling credit risk, 150 years ago for
liability insurance
risk on ships, and a lot of those problems have come a long way. And I think we're at a stage now where we can start maturing cyber risk. Are there any other questions? No, it sure was great to see so many people interested in this. And the FAIR Institute is up to 8,000 members, almost. Last year, it was at 5,000. So that's a 60% increase in 1 year. So this is starting to really take off. So let's keep the community going. And there may be a chapter near you. You can check that out on the FAIR Institute. And if you have any more questions or you want to correspond with Allison or I, hit us up on LinkedIn or any other
method
you want. Okay.
Thank you.